That's right.
Is it red?
Yes, sir.
Very beautiful. Oh. All right, what y'all want to do today? Can you get breathing? What's that like? Anybody got anything?
Well, I'm living in a wick, all right?
Okay.
And so,
I'm planning on going to the transition house, but I'm also going back home to work for a week. And, you know, I'm just kind of worried about, you know, what I'm going to face on the outside world, you know, when I leave here. Because, you know, I know that I didn't want to come back on my 48-hour fast. Sure didn't want to come back after surgery. And, you know, it's just, you know, I know this is a better place for me to be because, you know, a temptation is not my friend, and you know, I don't want to risk it trying to, you know, live out there right now because I know I'm not ready.
You know. Y'all shut up.
Yeah, shut the fuck up already.
Does that have to be all that hostility in there, too?
Y'all hush. Try to figure out what was going. Don't answer, please, because you don't know. What I'm going to suggest is try to figure out how it is y'all created a junior high classroom just then and what was going on in you. I'm not getting on you, it's just, you know. I mean, because there's real shit going on in this world right now. Mm-hmm. Dangerous stuff. Our culture is actually watched the debate and have listened to some of the news and the talking heads manipulating all that stuff. And, there's some dangerous stuff going on. And there's a polarization going on where people are lining up behind their saviors. Trump has generated a real movement because he's saying things that people think.
Yes.
Okay. The danger with that, though, is that people surrender their power to a would-be savior, because he ain't a savior either. I mean, it's kind of refreshing for folks. You know, I mean, Hillary is one thing that happened. I'm going to get to that, baby. Okay. But one of the things that happened in the last week, because did any of y'all watch the debate?
A little bit.
It said somebody released a video where Trump said that basically when you're rich, women will come up to you and you can grab their pussies if you want to. Which is true. Okay. But then the other side of the people go, he said pussy, and he's basically taking, because he was just talking shit, apparently. I mean, I don't know the man. And he's a billionaire, and he's tall, and he's got funny hair. But sometimes there are some women that don't give a shit about that. You understand that? I mean, some of y'all had an extra hit of crack and some woman let you grab her pussy. So, you ain't even a billionaire. That doesn't mean all women are like that or whatever. But they were just, the other side was feigning this outrage that he says it's okay to sexually assault women and just blah, 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 blah. So Trump shows up with four women that Bill Clinton fucked.
No.
Jennifer Flower. Yeah, y'all too young. Y'all don't even remember all this stuff. All these women. All them people. And they were sitting on the front row. While Hillary was dogging out Trump about saying pussy 10 years ago on this tape. And Bill looked like he was a walking death anyway, but creepy old fuck. But, and then there were several other Republican leadership that goes, oh, he said pussy, whatever, we can't support. And this is, one of them is John McCain, which is this low down piece of whatever, from all reports. And oh, he feigned this thing. And Trump basically said, I don't need y'all. Okay, so that just makes all his support better. One of the dangers with that is, I think, he might be in league with the Clintons. I don't know. And if he loses or if something comes out and is generating all this hope in these millions of people that he's going to save them, if he don't, I think the whole thing will collapse into a depression. Because it was similar to the Tea Party stuff, but all them tea, y'all remember that? And all them Tea Party people are just jack-offs anyway. They ain't done nothing. They lied to everybody. Got them all excited that something's going to happen different. You know? And it's very interesting to watch. But Trump's main thing is, according to him, he hadn't taken any money from the normal folks. That people, you know, you go, basically all these politicians just walk in front of these rich people like hookers and say, what kind of blowjob do you want for $100 million or whatever? And then they'll say one thing on TV, and then, I mean, they ain't even had a budget in 10 years, which is constitutionally, I think, isn't it, required? You know? So it's all a bunch of head game stuff going on. And I don't know what to think about it yet. And I don't know that we'll know till we know. So. But the main point I would say is, remember there are no saviors.
Can you speak up a little bit, sir? We're having a regular trouble hearing back here.
Okay. Well, turn the air off. There's not going to be some political savior ride in on a white horse and fix everything. Our programming teaches us to look outside ourselves for answers. Right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. From a large cultural perspective to, I'm sad, I need some woman to make me feel good. We're looking outside ourselves for answers. You know, my first response to your question, baby, is you're going to experience whatever you take out there with you. You know, and you've been here for 90 days or so, and every time I saw you or you heard me talk, I said, you need to pay attention to you. Okay? And you did some, I think. Maybe, I don't know. You know, I don't. Because if you were the better able you know you, you'll know what you're going to expect. You know? You know, and if you're that scared, why are you leaving?
So I gotta waste money.
Why?
I have bills.
And what they gonna do, eat you?
Just run my credit. Although it's pretty, it's pretty screwed right now. So. I don't know, I'm just broke. You know, I gotta go home and work, you know. I just know within these next four days.
If you had $1 million in the bank, you'd be broke.
who told me, "Will you shut up, you old fart?"
I mean, you're serious right now, right?
Like, you know, I just, you know, I'm scared, you know, in some ways, and I know that if I do everything that I know I'm supposed to, and, you know, don't go outside those guidelines and be where I'm supposed to be and whatnot, then I'll be fine, you know? But a part of me, you know, because what I'm working is the Tile Digger Super Speedway, so, you know, when I'm only going to be a ton of alcohol everywhere you look, so, I mean, you know, that's going to be one of the better things in the world there.
Which, what? You know, girl showing you their titties?
Oh, yeah, you know, I ain't seen no titties now in like 35 days, so. I mean, it's drought. But, you know, there's also a bunch of drugs and stuff out there, you know?
Well, there's drugs on this campus.
I mean, yeah, there's a good point there. You know,
do I need to get the dog out here?
I mean, I don't know. It's just.
I can call him right now. He'll bring that dog and we can.
Yes, do it.
What?
I got an ounce of crack in my room. Go do it.
No, I mean, oh, you want to be gangster bitches? I mean, fuck you. If you bringing that shit on here. Fuck you and your ancestors. That produced your pitiful little bitch ass. God damn.
Degenerates.
And see, and we're all laughing and it's fun and the fuck, there's serious shit going on. There's serious shit going on with you, with your family. So what do you want me to, what? You know the answer.
Yeah, I know. I know I do.
And you fake yourself out.
You're right.
And that's what most people do here for 90 days. They kill time. Same old bullshit. Different people. And then they're about to get out and they go, "Oh, fuck." Or not, because they got their plans already set and they're just trying to get out of the thing with the court or the wife or their kids.
Just trying to show them that certificate.
You know, which I ain't mad at, whatever. You know. But the same shit's going to happen again. And typically it gets worse every time. Till finally you're dead or you go, But I mean, it's fine. Death is cool. When you die, you're finally going to go, "Oh, this all was bullshit." You'll finally learn how to breathe. you'll finally go, "Oh, I'm not my body. I'm not my thoughts. I'm not the story that I told."
Wow.
You know? I mean, it's going to happen one way or another. It's just, it's real painful the longer you wait. And it gets more painful till we finally go, I will do this. Because I had talked to, who was it?
Justin.
About, because he kept having these dreams or these issues with women, right? Anybody in here got issues with women?
what are issues here? What are we talking about here?
You do, because you got to have a titty to survive. You just said it.
I just said it's going to be the nicer part of the race. I mean, I'm going to be pumping shit, man. So when you're pumping shit, wouldn't you like to see a titty every once in a while when you're covered in crack?
If a girl shows you her titty while you're covered in crap, I don't think I want to see those titties, no.
I mean, you'd be surprised how many people are
having. Why are you talking about you? You're talking about me. Don't say you would be surprised. You don't know fuck about me. Talk about yourself.
Sorry.
That's why you're fucking trapped. And you think you know something that you don't know. You hear me, baby?
Yeah, I hear you.
You're just talking shit. And I'm not being ugly. You asked me to get in your business, so I'm here.
Mm-hmm. I understand.
Cause there's a feeling, I don't know if you've experienced it or not, but there's a feeling when we're talking shit, it's not substantial. It feels like we're outside. And when I did that, it's like you went and you settled back down inside yourself. Mm-hmm. Do you understand?
Yes, sir.
That's where you're powerful. That other shit only works with other bitches. And y'all play the I'm a bigger bitch than you thing. You know?
Yeah, I understand.
I mean, the whole racing thing, I ain't mad at the racing thing, but it's little short guys that's driving cars real fast. I mean, you know? They don't have no 6'5 car drivers. Right? You can pick them up by their ankle and pack them around like this. It's another game. It's not bad. I ain't saying it's bad. It's just another fucking game. And they go around, turn to the left, turn to the left, turn to the left. You know, round and round and round. This is another version of the same game we play all the time. Go round and round and round the same circle. And maybe somebody will show me their titty. If I do it fast enough. And I, from time to time, I hear you guys talk about getting tired of the same old, same old, same old, same old, same old. Same old. Same old. Same old. So what we were talking about, is he was having these issues, repetitive issues with females. And it don't matter what version it is. I mean, especially in the Christian culture, we're the most sexually obsessed religion there is. You know, when you say somebody's living in sin, you're not talking about they cheated on their income tax. You know. And I hear very few sermons preached out of the Song of Solomon. Y'all ever read that? Here, look, find that for me, Song of Solomon. Y'all, who don't know what that is, Song of Solomon? Let me read you something, baby. What is it?
Song of Solomon, 86. Placement as a seal upon your arm, as a seal upon your heart. Your love is as strong as death. Your jealousy is unyielding as the grave.
You getting over, you know. Solomon. All right. All right, Psalms. Where is that sucker at? It's in what they call the wisdom literature. It's after Proverbs. Song of Songs, they call it sometimes. And it's right after Proverbs or Ecclesiastes. Chapter 1, verse 1, she says, "Let him kiss me with the kisses of his mouth. For your love is more delightful than wine. Pleasing is the fragrance of your perfumes. Your name is like perfume poured out. No wonder the young women think you are hot. Take me away with you. Come on, baby, let's hurry. let the king bring me into his chambers. That's just how it starts. You horny boys may want to read that sometime.
I was shocked when I first read it.
He talks about drinking the juices of her pomegranate.
Ooh.
How hot her feet look in sandals. That her, look at you, you're going to be touching yourself, aren't you? See? Just, I don't want to see it jerking now. Let's see what else. That her breasts are like, what, dates? And he's going to climb that tree and pick her fruit. They're probably not going to preach that at Highlands next week. Okay? The whole Christian narrative, or in the book anyway, ends with a marriage and a consummation of that marriage between a bride and a groom. Okay, Jesus is going to drink wine again and get some, I guess. Okay? Now, this part of our religion is not addressed, at least in the way I was raised. Right?
Right.
And that's the part, those feelings of longing and incompleteness and the idea that there is that perfect one out there. And it's manipulated, especially in Disney movies and shit, that the prince is going to come rescue the princess. Or the poor little girl's going to grow up and marry the princess. That's basically Pretty Woman's story. Yeah. Or that I'm an ugly monster, but this woman is going to calm me down and make me acceptable. That is Beauty and the Beast. Now, all these themes are played over and over and over and over. And contribute to us looking outside ourselves for answers and completeness. Y'all hear me? Mm-hmm. And we project those needs that are very valid and real and true onto this woman, that woman, this person, that person. And not knowing that the answer to it does not lie outside of me. Even in our search for God, we're looking out there for God, aren't we? We're waiting on the Savior to come sprinkle Jesus dust on us and make it all right one day. And that ain't what Jesus said. The kingdom of heaven is among you. It's within you. Can't you see it? Can't you perceive it? It's here. It's already here. Not one day. Not after you do your tricks, and then if you do the right tricks, then you'll get on the good list and get presents at the end. Now, one of the things I told Boy to do in terms of getting to know yourself is take all those, especially you romantic types, and all of you are to some degree, because that's part of being a human being. Because it don't matter how many titties you see, touch, taste, smell, it's not going to make that desire, that longing go away, because it's always incomplete. Right? Some of y'all have had 1,000 different women. You know? Or 800 anyway. Probably not good as Wilt Stilt Chamberlain, but you know, and every time, maybe not every time, sometimes you just did it because your Nintendo wasn't working, but which is the same thing. But every time, every new relationship, there's that hope that finally this thing will be resolved in me. That there's a place of peace and rest that I can go. You understand what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
That I'm alive, I'm open. Because if sex is good, part of it is the ego breaks down. And you lose yourself, right? And it's worship. Oh, God. I mean, it's worship. It's, anybody know Leonard Cohen? Y'all ever heard of Leonard Cohen? He's the one that wrote the song Hallelujah that people were singing now forever for a minute on, you know. Let me read you those. Let me find if this phone will work here. Let's see. How do you spell Hallelujah? It's got a J in it, doesn't it?
H-A-L-A.
Y'all were... The song goes, now I've heard that there was a secret chord that David played and it pleased the Lord. But you don't really care for music, do you? It goes like this, the fourth, the fifth, the minor fall, the major lift, the baffled king composing, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Your faith was strong, but you needed proof. You saw her bathing on the roof. Her beauty in the moonlight overthrew you. She tied you to a kitchen chair. She broke your throne. She cut your hair. And from your lips, she drew the hallelujah. Y'all know that woman, don't you?
The Lolliver.
Hmm?
Bathsheba.
He's not preaching, y'all. He's writing a song. Listen. You say I took the name in vain. I didn't even know the name. But if I did, well, really, what is it to you? There's a blaze of light in every word. It doesn't... Where's it go? Doesn't much matter what you heard, the holy or the broken, hallelujah. I did my best. It wasn't much. I couldn't feel, so I tried to touch. I've told the truth, and I didn't come here to fool you. And even when it all went wrong, I'll stand before the Lord of song with nothing on my tongue but hallelujah. The hallelujah, the oh my God, the breaking of the ego, the yes, this is it. The praise that comes out of our brokenness. Y'all hear me? It's deep. It's real. It's what our soul longs for. He has another song where he talks about there are cracks in everything, but that's how the light gets in. And he's a Jewish fellow. And has a following of me. I mean, he's in his 70s now, I guess. Most of his songs, a lot of them are romantic based, and they're talking about the broken love that we all experience. There are no perfect forms. It's another line, I think he says. Oh, he says, forget your the perfect gift, because we don't have any perfect gifts to bring to God. And I guess... Anyway... what I talked to Boy about, and if some of y'all are actually serious about this, you may try it. What I told him was, because he was writing love letters and stuff, you know. Any of y'all ever written love letters? Okay. But he's written love letters to 10 or 15 women over the, you know, and it was all the same. And he got to be a better poet after a while. But I suggested that he write those love letters to himself. And he did. And it's there's him reading it and talking about it is on the website. And then you asked me a while ago, what does all that mean? And what would it look like, right? And I told you what? Everything I've ever written. So I'm going to read y'all something. Let me see if I can find something here. And talk about it. Because until you know or begin to know yourself, it doesn't matter if you work at the racetrack or you're the president of the bank or you're whatever. You know? And when you talked about the devil wife last week, she ain't the devil. You know? Y'all just did a deal with each other where she'll do some things as long as you do some things. And called it love or called it whatever. And you're just in a position now that you're the bad boy and she keeps trying to fix the bad boy or something. I mean, it's the same old patterns. It's not...
same old shit, different day. Yeah. I just keep revolving myself in the damn door over and over and over.
Yeah. And the reason, and it's not because you're stupid or you're evil or whatever, even that you're weak. It's that I wish I had a mirror. Here's a mirror. When we're looking outside ourselves to fix ourselves, and we have an itch. If I think that's me, I'm scratching it. And I keep itching. If I think I'm going to fix somebody and then I'll be all right, I'm playing in a mirror. And I don't address what my needs are, what my itch is, what my longings are. Is that making sense? Because I'm not dealing with me. I'm dealing with an illusion, a reflection. You know? And I happen to like titties. I think they're marvelous. Okay? Oh, yeah. I'm not against titties. Don't quote me on that.
I have no clue how that was
hanging. Good luck getting that
haircut. Yeah, it's where the you got, it looks like squash bugs. That's what it looks like. Because y'all had an invasion of squash bugs this year.
Yeah, just leave it there.
What are squash bugs?
I hate squash bugs. Squash bugs are from the devil. The best way to kill them is just soapy water. Because it clogs up their breathing apparatus and they just...
just like that one did.
Hmm? That took them 10 seconds, then. You don't have to put no bad poison on. And for years, let's see. Okay, this is called home. There's only one place that can hold my attention. In fact, it is called to me from before the foundations. Has anybody ever had the sense that there's an answer, there's a... Even if we think it ought to be different, and we, even if we're not able to define it, there's something in us that knows there's an answer. Mm-hmm. Do you understand?
No.
Because if we didn't already know that, we would have no context for saying this is right and this is not it. You know, so there's some level you already know, or you wouldn't be able to discriminate between one thing and another. Okay. The problem is we don't know that we know, and we keep looking in the mirror trying to figure it out. You know. So that when I'm saying, in fact, it is called to me from before the foundations, before I even knew who I'm talking about infancy. I'm talking about before whatever there was any self-awareness. It beckons my senses, whispering to my flesh to seek, to move, to explore. Well, we've all done that. When we were still babies, like you were talking about your babies last week. You know, they're just playing. They're moving, they're exploring, they're seeking, they're skinning their knees and getting up and doing it some more. And, you know, and they're living life. They're not thinking about living life. You know? And they need to know, don't jump off a cliff. That's important, you know. They, you know, they need a little direction and stuff. Don't run out in the street and handle your shit over here. You know, it's kind of important things. But they're not ultimate, because we could be still shitting our pants and we're not going to go to hell. We just, our sphere of influence would be, you know, quite minimized. But there are actually people that have these clubs, they're grown people, they like to wear diapers and shit their britches. So you can, even if that you, that's your thing, you can find people to do that with. You know? I mean, there's actually people like that. And they went from quiet longings, muted dissatisfaction, sometimes boredom, or it may be ravenous hunger, desire calling me to go out not knowing, to once again leave that which is not in search of what is. I've sorted through much of what is not. I've traveled to exotic lands and lived among its people. I mean, I spent a year or more in Africa. Thought God was over yonder. You know? And He was. But He was in Gina, Louisiana too. I grew, I learned, but what I sought was not there. I searched the ancient writings and consulted the white-haired teachers. I spent 23 years in school looking for answers to stuff. I grew, I learned, but what I sought was not there. I played the world's game, trading myself for the trappings, the spoils of it. I grew, I learned, but what I sought was not there. I became a good man, but the emptiness remained there in my so-called good. And I became a bad man. I looked at strange titties.
Yes.
But even there was no sustenance. It too was an illusion. You know? Some of y'all asked me if I had a drug problem. I said, well, I have had a crack problem before. You know? Not the kind you smoke. All the things I've seen, all the things I have done, no matter the promise, no matter the sacrifice, each at the end answered with a resounding no, this is not it. We talked briefly about the book of Ecclesiastes, not Ecclesiastes, what, yeah, vanity of vanity, all is vanity. That's all that book is about. Is he went and did and tried and at the end of it, he goes, nope. That wasn't it either. This is not it. This is not the thing. This is not the place I sought. And the space remained empty, longing, aching for consummation. And the whole story of Christianity is the consummation and getting there. The split between the bride and the groom is healed. They're one now. But there is a space which cannot be measured or mapped. Its breadth and length are beyond reckoning. The senses lose their bearing on the horizon of here and there, and they are undone, remade. Once the masters, that is, the senses, were once the masters, now the slave. Eyes may notice a form that quickens the blood without reason. The ears may hear a sound, a voice that stirs, that lifts ever hopeful soul. The tongue may savor a kiss, exquisite and unique, a taste reminiscent of homecoming. And you've been with a lady, perhaps, that when you were with her, it felt like home. You understand? Okay. For a minute. And then it got messy again and fights and da-da-da-da-da. Because sometimes we can get addicted to people in that feeling and think that is real. And it is on some level. But it is not the ultimate answer to the loan. And some of y'all are involved in relationships right now where fuck heroin, that's your addiction. Right? You understand, baby? You know? And I'm going to say again and again and again, the impulse is righteous. Right? The problem is, as we're seeking to answer that longing, that feeling, that whatever, we continue to look outside. And that person, we project our stuff onto them. Have you ever dated or been with some woman that you thought was the most beautiful thing in the universe? And all your friends are like, what about that one tooth going down, you know? You know? You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
Yeah. Or whatever. Because really what has happened is she's become beautiful because you projected all those things that you need and want onto her. Have any of y'all ever put a woman up on the pedestal and then she didn't like you no more? Because she couldn't live up to what, how you thought about her or needed her to be or whatever. So that wasn't her. You're not dealing with a real woman. You're dealing with the projections of your own beauty onto her. And human beings can't be a god or a goddess. You might can for 20 minutes at a time. You know? And that's part of what Cohen was talking about, his broken hallelujah. You know, in his, because he has a series, from what I hadn't read his whole story, just from his songs. A lot of them are these bittersweet, lovely, sad love songs that repeat this same kind of thing. I thought she was it, but she wasn't. Or she broke my heart, or whatever. The tongue may savor a kiss, exquisite and unique, a taste reminiscent of homecoming. A fragrance may echo, loosening the bonds, connections which bind soul to body. You know, in the spring when the honeysuckles hit the air. And in all our stuff, sometimes that fragrance just makes us still. You know what I'm saying? It's sweet. It's beautiful. It's, you know. Waves of energy course through flesh as it crosses the threshold of there. Tender, sweet, intimate expanse. It now exists and boundaries have no meaning. I is left behind as something new bursts into being. Lifted up, energy, light, fierce passion, quiet rest, as two become one. Part of the magic or the mystery of real lovemaking has to do with our ego being broken and surrendered. Y'all hear me? And you and her together become something more. Right? And it's not about humping some hole. You would kill somebody that thought about her like that. Right? Right? Mm-hmm. Because she is your beloved. At once a place of losing and finding, forgetting and remembering all. This is my home. She is my beloved. I'm going to read something else. If I can find something else. Suggest somebody in here try it and then you can talk about it. Are any of y'all like romantic poetry or write it? Are any of y'all poets?
Oh, I do.
Okay. You are?
No, I like it. I haven't done a lot of reading in a while.
One of the things that I found that helped me is for years and years, since I was in high school, I would write love poetry. You know? Yeah. Because for some reason, in some instances anyway, I was attracted to these beautiful, crazy women. Broken in some ways. Okay. What I have found out was I am beautiful and broken. You know? And try think about trying this. Sometime this week, write a love poem to yourself in those same with those same kind of images, and you may end up weeping. The lost beloved is us, you know. The Greeks talk about, when they talk about a soul, they use two words, anima and animus. One of them is feminine and one of them is male. And as they thought about the soul, a man's soul is always described in the feminine terms. A woman's soul is described in a masculine term. And biologically, we all have estrogen, even us. Women also have testosterone. Just given the way that the DNA information went, you ended up with a pecker or a vagina. Okay, men, every 28.5 days, men go through cycles also. We just don't bleed. You know, it's not as pronounced until we get older and our testosterone goes down and our estrogen starts going up. And we end up crying at a Kodak commercial or something. We go, what the hell's wrong with me? You know what I'm talking about? You know. I'm trying to think. Okay, I'll do this. This was a love song I wrote a long time ago. If I can find it. And I'm going to read this. I'm definitely not going to sing it because y'all would have to leave. But where is the sucker at? Hell. Will somebody with OCD come put this in an order for me? I have non-OCD. But I wrote this thinking about a woman a long time ago. That ain't it. Okay. Well, I'll read. Say a bad word. Would you look in there? Somewhere in there, there's one that's called I Need You. Wishes. Maybe I remember it. It goes something like this. And it was, I wrote this on a day I was sad, sad, sad. Longing with aches that hurt physically. Does anybody ever feel like that?
Yes, sir.
Now, it doesn't count coming off heroin, but it's similar, and chemically it's similar. Pining with a broken heart is chemically similar to the coming off heroin. Okay. And I was thinking about, I wouldn't even think, I was just feeling all this stuff, and sometimes for me when I'm feeling stuff, writing words helps. But it said, sometimes I get lost, and I have found that as this crazy world keeps spinning round, the distractions of the day are not enough to make you go away. You haunt me. The part. You haunt me. And when I sense you near, my anticipation grows, and I know sometimes that my frustration shows. But like a drowning man needs air, it's hard to breathe without you here. Mm-mm. You heal me. Oh, where's one, the cool little verse, what's it go? So it ends up where you fit me. And as I wait for you, the clock, it moves so slow. and I'm not so sure if time is friend or foe. For the place I want to be is with you eternally. I need you. In the other verse, I forgot, it was talking about no one can fit me. I know no matter what I do, no one can fit me quite like you. You fit me. Now, if I write that and think about that to myself, that's what I need. From me. No one can fit me quite like me. No one can heal me. I have to do that myself. And I'm not gonna get into all the Christian stuff, but because at some point, who you are, who God is, it all kind of, it's one. It's what Jesus said, right? There's not a sense of I. But when you have those impulses or those longings, play with it and talk to yourself. I wish I had dudes. Have you written a love poetry lately? You got something in there that don't say Jesus in it? Think about some of the things you promised your woman to get her back. What have you said to her? Can somebody remember anything?
I've changed
the standard stuff.
No, but when you...
Not
manipulation. No, I ain't talking about that bullshit.
I promise to treat you like you deserve.
I promise to treat you like you deserve to be treated. That's what I'm, that kind of stuff.
Put you on a pedestal.
Treat you like whatever. I'm blank. You are so beautiful. There's no one like you. All right, y'all. Quit. Who's singing that?
Me.
Sing that to yourself.
I'll try.
I mean, really. Because what if you treated you like you deserved? Really, not this fake shit.
No.
What if you honored yourself?
We'll be here.
What if you realized that you are beautiful? That you're fearfully and wonderfully made? That there is no one like you. Y'all feel the weirdness of that? And I'm going to talk about it in your head. Because some of y'all have got some good lines to try to get some woman naked and look at her tootie. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about stuff that just rises up out of you. And you're telling the truth. Or at least as you see it, you know, where you're studying the little golden flakes in her brown or blue eyes or green eyes, and you think that is so amazing. The way her lip does when she, or her nose squinches when she's laughing, or the way that her favorite perfume smells different on her than it does some other woman. because of her unique biology. Y'all hear me? Hip. That's different from any other hip that's ever curved. Any of y'all loved a woman like that?
Yes, sir.
Because you studied her. Right? What I'm telling you is study you like that. You are singular and unique and exquisite. Already. The way you do is unlike any way anybody else does. And you don't have to be all upset because you're not your creator, so you don't get the credit for that. So it's not an ego thing. My daughter, sweet girl that she is, was telling me she appreciated some stuff about her mom and I and how we raised her. And I was like, baby, I can't take no credit. You know, if we did anything, we tried to let her be who she is and recognize who she is apart from us. But I didn't create her. I didn't create me. But I can study my daughter, and which is really my only job as her daddy, is to try to know her really, outside of my own ego needs, and hopefully, you know, train up a child in the way that they should go. That's not teaching us to enforce some rule or some ego identity on a child. It's more like training a grapevine. Any of y'all ever grown grapes or whatever, or tomatoes, I guess? Training up a child in the way that they should go is about putting up a trellis and giving them support for their own natural growth. Not anybody try to train a tomato plant? Tomato plants is ugly. You know? They're very imperfect in terms of the form of them. They're not all real pretty, huh? Yeah. The perfection of a tomato plant is not in its form, it's in its fruit that it produces. You know? And we focus on the form so much and miss the point of the fruit. At work play this, I was talking to the people about bringing some ideas, and I'd write them a poem and we'd perform it and stuff. And this mother brought a poem that her son had written called The Color of Me, or I don't even know if he titled it. It doesn't matter. And so I wrote this thing. And the point of it is, it says, what color am I, or what is the color of me? What is my fragrance? What are the numbers of my days? Who's going to join me along on the way, kind of thing. And while I was doing it, or as I was performing it, the thought struck me that is a much better set of questions than what is my purpose? What's the purpose of your life and God's plan and all that stuff? Anybody been struggling with that for like decades? I mean, and when we're looking for our quote purpose, as we have been taught it, it is basically, I need to go play the game, be successful in the game.
Do it right.
Huh?
Do it right.
Do it right. Keep your eye on the ball, da da da, all this stuff. As though God's will for your existence in the universe is to be a plumber, or make cabinets, or play with computers, or whatever. I mean, what's the purpose of a bird singing? I mean, the bird's not going, I'm going to make these sounds so that it'll be pretty music for these human people.
Serenade
communication? I don't know. What's the purpose of a flower? What's the purpose of honeysuckle smelling so good? Purpose is the wrong way of thinking about it. It's not a purpose, it is. It's beautiful. You know? It's like saying, I'm going to go dance so I can get to the end of it. The purpose of the dance is to dance, not to go, okay, I've succeeded. I'm finished the dance now. Y'all hear me? And our beloved, our unknown soul, understands this. We all long to be beautiful, not to just make money for some woman, or that's some of the fights you have with females, right? Because you feel like you're a purpose rather than a being. True?
Yes, sir.
And then they feel like they're a hole and you just want to hump them. Because they're feeling like a purpose. I'm just here to touch your special place. That's all you want. Right? Because we're focused on the wrong thing. But when it's right, you're telling her how pretty them golden flakes look in her eyes. And meaning it. And you're amazed by it. And there's no 3 points in it's being and existing and playing. And your purpose is to be you. That is your purpose. That's it. And we go the exact damn opposite way from that. You know? I said last week or week before, I come here because it's fun. And that's the truth. There's no other reason. You know? Retail, I make $150 an hour. And when I have groups, it's $30 a head. How many would that be? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. But I don't do this because it's part of what I, it's me, just being me. Y'all hear me? Good or bad or whatever, it's just me. You know, this part of my hair curls weird. You know, but that's part of me. And I don't know what I will be in 5 years or 10 years or, but I can't get there till I'm here. You know, we never get here so many times. Yeah, I mean, you got to start at the beginning. Your beloved is calling you. Eric Clapton's beloved used to be cocaine. He wrote a love song to her. And we have romantic attachments to the substances many times we use. Right? It's my baby. Except tonight the bottle let me down. Something. You know? Because the problem is not the ingestion of substances. That's not our problem. Our problem is that we don't know our beloved. We don't know ourselves. It's when you love your beloved, you're not really tempted to go fuck around on her. It's not like, oh, I have to be a good guy and not. You don't even think about it, but you're like, I'm getting to my beloved. When we have some sense of our beloved, we're not going to cheat on our beloved with heroin. Because heroin is a hooker. I mean, it's not this big fight. You're like, I don't want that skank. I got a beloved. Y'all hear me? It's not about squeezing your ass cheeks tight and going out into the world and not doing whatever. But we will always remain addicted to something until we begin to figure out our beloved. You know? I mean, the Christian story, I mean, who's going to... The beloved metaphor is the only one that turns me on. You know, seeking the lost sheep doesn't have a whole lot of impact on me. Vines and all that stuff. That you are exquisite, you are beautiful. You are singular in the universe. And let's see if I can find it. This is called grief, one tear. And this is part of the process of learning what is and ain't your beloved, and it hurts. Okay? There's no way around this part. I have penned no words for you since forever. Out of time, though, my heart has done nothing but call your name. Over and over, I find myself following paths that lead to you. Or rather, they lead to places where I realize your absence. The separateness is startling and unreal. Grief too deep for words or tears, for they only well up in me. And perhaps I cannot weep because I cannot come to terms or accept. Perhaps I cannot weep because I cannot accept or come to terms with it. Or perhaps I just refuse to. But how can I come to terms with what is impossible? Just one tear would contain the sadness of the whole world. Perhaps that is why they will not flow. It would be too terrible. The breaking and the destruction of the ego is a grief process. Letting go of all this stuff that we thought we are. Sad. But it's very cool. Because you're going to experience grief anyway. You already do. That's why y'all play so much here, because you're keeping all that stuff away. It's a distraction from the work that needs to happen. And it's not really even stuff you need to do or figure out. You just need to be still. Boom! Got that on tape too, baby. Like Daniel's son, kitchen. Wax on, wax off, baby. This is called glorious destruction, and it's another image of what I'm talking about. Can I discover the beauty of you, O my soul? And this was at a point where I was starting to turn toward where it needed to go. By what way should I travel in my search? Because I see some of y'all, when I'm talking about this, it's like a light's trying to come on, but then you... Okay, well, how do I do that? You know what I'm talking about? By what way should I go in my search? Some said that if I could merely glimpse you, I could rest from my wanderings. I could be sustained by the glory of you. The sweetness of your breath, the curve and shape of you, the music of your laughter and the light in your beautiful eyes. They say before you, I will die and be reborn at once. Your ego will die and you'll be reborn. You, the object of my desire, where is your habitation? I have known you from before forever, and you haunt my dreams. You lie just outside of my waking consciousness. The females in your dream, understand that's your soul calling to you. And if you don't listen to her, she'll turn into a bitch in your dreams. Y'all hear me? Going, ah, your pecker's too short. But the woman in your dream many times will treat you the same way you're treating yourself. It's just backwards in a mirror. You have been the force, the pull, the restless hunger in me. I am dry and barren and almost done. I need to drink from your spring that I may live. I weep wanting you. But the few tears I have left merely fall and disappear into the dust at my feet. And my longings may very well break my heart. But I would joyfully welcome the shattering of myself upon you that I might be pieced back together a better man. Like a great clipper ship of old, I long to crash onto your shores and be broken. Guide me in that glorious destruction that I might be remade in you. And if you take those images and think about Paul when he's talking about dying to self and being reborn in Christ and all that, that is similar stuff is what I'm talking about. It's just different words. Because we hear that stuff in church so much it don't even mean nothing. We equate dying to self with, well, you can't have a beer. No. Hell no. That's not what that, or you know what I'm talking about, or some cultural whatever. If you were in Germany, they'd go, why haven't you had your beer? You need to finish your beer, you know. When you're 10 at supper. Okay, so, I mean, that's just a cultural thing. And the Western world so screwed up about sex and all that stuff is because we act like it's all, you know, the more you make laws about stuff, the more people, it goes underground and, you know. Oh, hell, I'm late. All right. Does this make any kind of sense at all?
Yes, it does.
Breathe stillness. Watch, write down your dreams. Look for stuff that make you go, that's weird. Okay? Not in other people.
In ourselves.
In yourself. Because what you see in other people is really your shit getting reflected right here. And a mirror is handy, you know, unless you think that's you. So, all right, go eat, bye.